welcome to Studio 411. I'm your host, Larry Dasilva, and we've got a terrific show for you today. We have in studio a gentleman who does a marvelous show that's aired practically all over the world at this point, a gentleman named Rich Appel, and the name of the program is called That Thing with Rich Appel. And before we talk to Rich about not only his career, the show, also the business, as many people talk about it, media, radio, and TV in general, let's watch a little clip from Rich on his program, That Thing with Rich Appel. Take a look.
That Thing with Rich Appel.
You and I, Appleheads, happy together for 100 shows, number 100 for 1967 in England.
Imagine me and you.
That's about as down as you can go, Cool and the Gang.
From the Chestnut Cabaret, it's That Thing with Rich Appel.
It's smoochy music time.
That Thing with Rich Appel.
Happy birthday, Meg Ryan, who made Loving Fun in a deli in the movie When Harry Met Sally. Think back to your first 45, that is. What was it? Tell us, and you might win some cool stuff. Scroll to the bottom of our website, thatthingshow.com. I want to be with you so we can groove tonight. This was number 100 of the year in Australia in 1982, the year before CDs were introduced. So I guess this wouldn't have worked after that. Earth, Wind, and Fire on That Thing.
Well, now you got a little behind the scenes as to what all that craziness is that's going on when you're listening to his show that airs on many stations throughout the country as well as different parts of the world. Our guest not only is an educator, as well as certainly someone who's been in the business for many years, has worked for Billboard, and we're going to uncover all the secrets in the life of this gentleman, Rich Appel. Rich, welcome. Thanks for joining us.
It's a pleasure to be here, Larry, and I don't think I've uncovered all the secrets in my life yet, but I'll help you anyway.
Hey, it's life is a never-ending, what do you call it, expedition, I guess would be the word, you know, looking for the lost mysteries. But yes, I actually ran across Rich's program a while back, and at first I was like, wow, what is this, you know, which is always a good thing, I guess, when it catches your eye. And then my wife and I would listen to it, especially on the weekend. In our area, it's on like on Saturdays, and I'd be like, wow, you know, this is pretty cool. I mean, this guy's playing a lot of stuff and old commercials and talks with guests. And I think the one that first caught my eye, or ear rather, was a gentleman we had on this show, a Burley Drummond, who was a founding drummer Ambrosia. And I said, whoa, I said, this guy's pretty good. I said, he's friends and talking to my buddy Burley. And then you've had our mutual friend now, Mary McDonough from the Waltons fame. So, Rich, tell us a little bit. It's kind of like an homage to various decades, correct?
You could say that. It's really, when I first was offered the chance to do this program, I knew I wanted to do something that wasn't like anything else on the radio. And the first thing that went through my head was, well, growing up, I used to love the pace and the excitement and the involvement of the, what they called then DJ, kids don't know that word anymore, on Top 40 radio, especially during what was known as the Drake era, during when stations like, for people in, the, I guess, in the Connecticut area, it was WPOP, where I was, it was WRKO in Boston, on the West Coast, KHJ and KFRC. All of these stations changed the tempo of radio, where the jingles were very quick and the disc jockeys had to talk only in those 15 seconds ramping up to the vocal of the song, and the commercials stood out because after the songs played, the commercials themselves had a lot of personality, and the jingles and the melodies from the commercials were almost as memorable as the songs themselves, and the humor involved, and just the whole interplay between all the elements, which we have to an extent still today in radio, but not quite what it was. So I said, well, let's try to bring that back. Let's Bring back the classic Top 40 era. Have some fun with it, but bring it into the now. Feature songs from really several decades. I mean, the sweet spot of the program is probably somewhere from the time the Beatles came to prominence to about the time where disco was happening, with a little bit on either end. Mm-hmm. So that, to me, was the peak of the fun of Top 40 radio. So that's what I try to do.
You talked about the commercials. A guest that we had on the show not too long ago, Lamont McLemore, again, founding member of the Fifth Dimension.
Sure.
You know, we may have talked about it, or I might have even uncovered, perhaps even was on your show, I don't recall, where, again, bands and solo artists would do jingles, again, commercials for whether it was Pepsi or Ford trucks or whatever. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if that happens. Not in radio anymore, anyway.
Well, today it happens more as an endorsement for a product without necessarily singing something that's original. You'll see an artist like, Katy Perry does the spots for Citibank or Citi, whatever it's known as now. And or you'll see Pitbull do the commercials for whatever the beer is, but they don't actually sing some original song
right
to accompany that. Whereas you're right, in the during the 1960s and 70s, especially with Coca-Cola, that was the big one. The artists would have a 60-second song, sometimes longer, written for them in their style to go with the Things Go Better with Coca-Cola tag or It's the Real Thing. And that was fascinating, and that was all over the radio. And it wasn't just Coke. It was maybe it was McDonald's as well.
Oh, sure, even airlines. I mean,
airlines.
I remember the Fifth Dimension, which I believe was a Jimmy Webb song. They did, you know, a variation on Up, Up, and Away,
for TWA. Yes. I mean, I have that commercial.
Yeah.
We're going to play that.
Yeah, and that's it's great. And like I said, they do. They run like it seems forever, and you're just like really getting into it. Maybe because we remember those commercials. I don't know.
No, I think, and there's collections. Some people, there's bootlegs out there somewhere. I think maybe they're now commercially available. Of many of those Coca-Cola commercials, many of which I've featured on the program. And you're right, they are, the commercials to me anyway are maybe the most exciting part of the program because it's the one part that you know most people haven't heard since they were actually aired. And maybe also true for a lot of the jingles, which we've recasted with our show acapellas and shouts to go with the old sounding jingles.
Absolutely, yeah. That thing with Rich Appel, host of that program, radio program, joining us for the hour on Studio 411. I have a dartboard similar to that, so you can kind of simulate that. Obviously, I'm not a good shot, but anyway, so we tried. You know, no one was injured in the making of this program, so that I can tell you.
Might have been in the making of that actual shot.
Give us the website where folks can get more information.
That would be thatthingshow.com. And that's where you'll find, by the way, a guide to whenever the show airs, by day, by time, because we're on almost, our starting times start anywhere from Friday morning, Eastern time, which might be early Saturday in Australia where the show is actually airing, up through early Monday where we're still on the West Coast and they're just starting to run it at
sure.
their late Sunday nights and our early Monday mornings. So nearly every hour is a start time for one of our stations. So we're easy to find and almost every station streams. And maybe if you're lucky, if you live in a certain area, you can pick the show up, as I know you do.
Yeah, oh yeah. I've got it covered
radio.
Between New York and Rhode Island. I know, mm-hmm. I know where to go to get it. And if one fades, I kind of switch to the other. It's become a pilgrimage to, you know, get that show. And as I said, it was just kind of on a fluke because like so many folks, we used to have, you know, serious, and it's that's good. I mean, obviously you're paying for it, whatever, and then for different reasons we just parted with it. And then when I heard this, you know, my wife and I kind of looked at each other like, wow, this is kind of almost a little bit of a throwback to that, where, you know, there's some talking, you know, there's some interaction, there's some, you know, celebrities, stuff maybe useless information that isn't so useless after all, whatever. Mm-hmm. And I just find it a real throwback. I'm going to throw a name out because I saw it in my notes. And of course, it's a guy that I thought was, you know, stupendous back in the day. Might still be alive, I believe. Dan Ingram, WABC, for many, many years. And again, he was a devil, I got to tell you, when he used to do some of his bits.
Yeah. You know. Yep. And certainly the thought of Ingram comes to mind when I put the show together, although you're right. Dan was an amazing disc jockey in an era when he could get away with murder figuratively, yeah, on the radio in terms of what he could say, even while reaching such a wide potential audience on a signal like WABC. And certainly I think of that a lot when I'm putting the program together, as what am I going to say? What comment am I going to make about this particular song? And I might do some type of double entendre like Dan did. But now it's a different world. Because if Dan were on today, people might listen to this. Well, there's two possible scenarios. One is that the station operator might hear it and say, "Well, you can't say that. You know, we're in a much more politically correct world today." So, and sometimes I'll say something on the radio, and then I'll say afterwards, "I wonder if anybody actually heard this and is going to get upset about it."
Well, you did an hour one time where it was songs, and I'm trying to remember what the core subject thing, but then you went out of your way to explain, oh, I know, songs with a stutter in them.
That's correct.
And all of a sudden, you know, My Generation by The Who, You Ain't Seen Nothing Yet by BTO, you know, many others, but those are the two I know that stick in my mind. And you went out of your way because you've said it on your show, so I don't think it's anything revelatory that we can share, that you yourself can relate to that.
Absolutely.
As a youth, you had a little bit of a problem.
I grew up with a speech impediment. Yeah. I was a stutterer all through high school and college, and I wanted so badly to be on the radio because it's all I knew as a kid. So I just worked so hard to eliminate that. And even today, I'll still fall into a situation where I might not get the words out. When I'm standing in front of a class, I might do that. Even sometimes on the mic, I'll realize when I'm recording the program, you know, I could have said that word better. I didn't actually get that out the way that I intended to do it. But yeah, we try to, as part of the program, and as you're aware, in the second hour of the show every week, we try to do something thematic or unusual to carry the hour. And in that case, if I'm not mistaken, that week happened to be Colin Firth's birthday, the actor who starred in The King's Speech.
Yeah, I remember.
So that's what inspired the idea. So we did The Who and My Generation and You Ain't Seen Nothing Yet and Benny and the Jets,
yes,
and all those songs with mock stuttering. And you're right, I wasn't going to do it, but then I said, you know, I really should put a disclaimer in here because I want to make sure people know that we're not making fun.
Right, not only that, but in your case, which stayed with me, was that not only did you go that route, and I understood perfectly why, but then I said, well, looky here, he shared a little something that obviously the average listener would have no idea. So that at that point, it really, I think, diffused any potential, you know, again, folks, because as we lived in such a high-charge world.
Larry, that's not to say there hasn't been controversy. I have had station operators come to me who have actually received email from listeners complaining about something that I said.
Yeah.
Which tells you, I find that to be really a praise kind of thing, because it means they're listening.
Sure,
because
absolutely.
So many people use radio as a background, and I realized when the radio that I came from, when I was doing regular FM radio, doing a weekend shift, this was only a few years ago, And I would do the same thing. I would have the list of all the songs, and I would write up material for it and do double entendres, and I would certainly have Ingram in the back of my head. And I would say stuff that I knew was outrageous, but I figured, well, let's see if anybody says anything. And 99 times out of 100, no one did, because we probably didn't have that many listeners. Or people listen with it in the background. They don't catch all these things that you're trying to say, which is, Ingram certainly understood that.
Sure. Oh,
and yeah. A lot of other disc jockeys as well. That was the fun of the program. If you really listen, you would hear little things like that. And every now and then, a listener does catch it. Case in point, a few weeks back, it was Vladimir Putin's birthday. I don't know if you heard this. Vladimir Putin's birthday. And we have a hit line in the program. We actually have a number you can call.
Not literally.
Yeah, not
okay, no, I just wanted to clarify.
Yeah, leave that in.
So I wouldn't get the letters, okay? Putin,
yes.
Hit line, you know.
No, okay.
He meant that in a different way, folks.
I used that term because I stole that from the Drake stations, too. Every one of those stations, they refer to their phone number, their request number, as the hit line. So we just got a toll-free number, which, by the way, shameless plug, 833-THAT-THING. Dial the number, the letters on the phone. People still do
and
that.
And they can leave requests,
and
right?
They can leave requests,
comments, so that's good.
Right,
so.
Or they can just tell me how great I am, which some people have done. Not that I'm expecting that. Or they can ask, they can do anything they want, really. That's the fun of it. But most people will ask for a song. So we decided to have fun with that. And so I, rather than have an actual call that I would edit into the program under the show, we had a bit with the White House calling, asking for me to play a song from the president to Putin.
Nice.
And the song that I played was James and Bobby Purify, Your Puppet.
I'm Your Puppet, wow.
So I thought, anybody gonna catch this? And I got a note, the night, I think it was the Sunday night the show ran on, I think it's WLNG, which is one of our biggest affiliates out in Long Island. And a listener said, I was on the floor. I love that you did that.
There you go. No, perfect. And that's, you know, you look at song titles, artists, you know, maybe perhaps what they're identified with or known for. And again, it not only can make whole, like, hours or segments. I mean, again, and that takes a creative mind to do that. And that's what caught my ear was I said, wow, this guy isn't just slapping together any old vinyl or A-tracks or streams or whatever. He's really thinking about what he's saying. And that's the key, is that you know what you're going to say, especially when you're trying to bridge a song or a bit. And mm-hmm. People don't realize the importance of that. Is that, you know, even here, when you kind of go on the air, welcome to the show, blah, 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 blah. And then sometimes I question myself, I should have done it different. But, you know, you can't beat yourself up. But in radio, you don't get a second chance. I mean, it's
exactly.
In your case, because it is taped for air, yeah, you can, you know, kind of make some modifications.
And while I realize, as we mentioned earlier, most folks are not going to even pick up on what I'm saying. They're going to pick up on the song. Because most times, while the program is on the weekends, and I'm checking Facebook, and I'm checking Twitter, and my email and messages, most often people will mention, oh, you played that song and it was a great song. But they might not mention something that I did or said that was related to like the Putin situation.
Yeah.
Or 'cause most of the program actually is that. The majority of the show, except for that second hour, most of the first and third hours are songs that are driven by an event that happened historically on the weekend dates or somebody's birthday, like Putin's. And sometimes it's just a silly pun. Like, we had one for the Explorer Magellan. You know, the guy, was he in the same era as Columbus?
Vasco da Gama.
Yeah. See, all your junior high history is coming back now.
Yes, we don't want to say Columbus these days. I don't know why, but I guess.
Well, as far as I know, Magellan was a good guy.
Yes, Magellan was good.
He had a song
written about him, too.
Well, I picked out a song. There was a song by Bobby Goldsboro called The Straight Life. So it's a play on words,
that, yeah.
You know, the Strait of Magellan.
Well, mine, that, again, claim to fame, I doubt this going to go in the archives, but was a song when I was in radio in the 80s by Stacy Ladisaw, and it was Love on a Two-Way Street.
Sure.
So I said, oh, Love on a Two-Way Street, oh, that must mean she swings both ways. So, you know, and that was, and I don't know if that would go over well today, you know, but again, it was probably over most people's heads. But anyway, so that's the, obviously, yeah. It went over Rich's head, too, so he didn't.
Well, I know, too, I realize a lot of cases that something I say might go over somebody's head. Oh, maybe I'm thinking, boy, if I'm really lucky, maybe somebody will actually go and Google and find out why I played a song if it wasn't all that clear. For example, a while back, and I'm sure neither of us remember this, maybe we read about it in our history books. Remember the famous Richard Nixon checkers speech?
Yes, oh yeah, before my time, but I remember
right.
seeing
52 campaign with Ike, and he was the VP nominee, and he was accused of having some campaign contribution, mm-hmm. and he went on national TV and pleaded to the public, talking about his dog, the little dog named Checkers, and the anniversary of that speech, when it was on. I talked about that and went right into the Paul Anka song, and they called it Puppy Love.
Oh, very good.
But most people probably wouldn't understand that, having not known about the speech.
I think it's just, again, we're here, whether it's our little show here or your marvelous show, that thing with Rich Appel, you're there to inspire people, to entertain them, to motivate them, to maybe make them think outside the box. And nowadays, instead of going to the encyclopedia, which might not have had it back in our day, you can just Google it and say, oh my goodness, now look at that. Whether it's Magellan or whether it's that thing or Studio 411, shameless plug, I know. But, it's just those kind of things. And I guess we're from a different era. I do those kind of things. Other people just right over their head.
See, my feeling is that people... What I'm trying to do, I keep saying this, and I don't know if it really takes. I don't know what listeners are really like. I don't have the research. But I'd like to think that what I'd like to do is change the way people listen to radio or change it back, even though you can't really change it back. A lot of people don't listen to radio actively, if they listen at all. And as I mentioned earlier, it's kind of like going back to the idea that people hear a song and will say something about the song, but not about what I said, even though what I'm trying to do is add entertainment into just a whole bunch of songs. You know, and I know, people can Google anything they want. Another part of my program is that I rarely, if ever, mention the title or artist of any song, because I figure either A, the listeners already know it, or B, if they don't know it, they can Google it.
Sure.
They don't need me to serve everything up and say, okay, this is the pasta primavera. I don't have to be the waiter.
But even now, your show, which was great when there was the interview you did with my friend Mary McDonough from Walton's fame for an event that was held here in Connecticut, I could go to the website.
Oh, thatthingshow.com.
Okay. And, then...
I should be testing you on that.
And then view the whole stream, view the whole program, or listen to it, I should say. You know what I mean? But it was just, and the reason I keep saying view, because I love that little promo that we ran at the beginning of the show. Mm-hmm. I think you need to do more of those.
I think you're right. And Larry, by the way, good point. I forgot about that. On my website... You can also get earlier programs. There's a link to shows that are archived going back, I believe, to maybe the middle of 2016.
Oh, yeah.
If anybody really wanted to do that, if you're a glutton for punishment, if you want to binge listen, you're more than welcome to do it at the link, if you can find it on the website.
No, I think it's great. Rich Appel, host of That Thing with Rich Appel. Tell me about some of the musical genres you grew up listening to. I mean, it sounds like it was pretty broad like myself, but,
probably not as broad as many other kids in our generation, because, I knew I had friends who would listen to classical music and jazz and show tunes and for me, it was always about top 40. I was one of four kids. My older brother was, I believe, 6 years older than me. And when I was 6 years old, I remember this exactly. It's one of my earliest memories, was going up the stairs. We lived in a colonial house, and when we were kids, it seemed like a big house. I go back to it now. My sister still lives there, you know, and it's like this size, you know. It's like
this like going back to your old grammar school.
Yes.
You know, which mine, they leveled a few years ago. I got to show my wife, I don't know, about 10 years ago, and then one year, I don't know, 5 or 6 years later, I went back, and I'm like, where is it? But with the first time, you know, probably 30 years ago, I happened to drive by there, and all of a sudden, I'm like, wow, this area that was in front of me, it looked like, you know, spacious, and all of a sudden, it was like this little, like the size of this desk. I said, we must have been running awfully slow, because I just seemed to be huge.
I think everything's like, when you're a kid, of course, the world is huge. We went to an amusement park when we were kids that I thought was like, you know, humongous. And then I went back to the site of it after they'd torn it down.
Yeah.
And some of the stuff was still there. And it's like, this was all it was? It was like a parking lot? How could this be? So when I went up to see my brother, he was frantically writing down all the songs on the countdown every week on the local station. This would have been WBZ in Boston.
Yeah, yeah.
And he was trying to explain this to me as a six-year-old. And I was enthralled with it, and I started writing him down myself. And I was obsessed with it, so much to the point that I didn't do anything else. I would come home and just listen to the radio. I didn't have any friends. My friends were the people on the radio. And there was another point I was going to make about that, but really, that was, most of my music was that. Maybe my parents might have wanted me to listen to something else, but eventually we did have some other genres. My mom used to work at a chain store. Not an electronic store, I guess it was, department store, Leachmere.
Oh, okay.
Remember that chain?
Yeah, I remember.
She used to work there, so she had a discount, and my dad used to go there every Saturday and pick up all these albums for real cheap. So for a while, we had this humongous collection of, and he would buy show tunes, and he would buy all the Rat Pack singers. So we had that in the house. Along with, but then I always came back to listening to Top 40. So to me, that's what really mattered. But knowing the other stuff does help. It does help put things in a wider perspective.
It's like a story I heard Little Richard, I don't know if you remember the old Robert Klein had a talk show for about a year, and Little Richard was on his show. And, you know, it was a great interview. I mean, he was in awe of Little Richard because he grew up in the 50s and 60s, even when some of his comedy bits used to be on that. But anyway, Little Richard told how, you know, in those days in the 50s, you know, there was a lot of bias. Or sometimes we say sometimes the more things change, the more they remain the same. But anyway, in those days with 45 records, for those who are too young to remember, there were artists like Pat Boone that were covering songs by black artists primarily. So he told Robert about how, you know, he had that song Tutti Frutti, and he said, yeah, the kids would keep, you know, Pat Boone's record on the dresser, on top of the dresser, but they would put mine underneath the socks and the underwear, because that's what they were really listening to, you know.
Yeah.
And again, it was just, some of them were brutal. I mean, Pat Boone is great an artist in terms of record sales that he had. I mean, the stuff he was covering, it was almost insane. You know, there was like this force, like beat and rhythm. I mean, it was nothing like this free-for-all of Fats Domino,
true,
Little Richard, so many others, you know.
But to Pat Boone's credit, because it's funny, I've had this conversation with people, and everybody points to the fact that Pat Boone badgered you, he completely destroyed these R&B classics. But to his credit, he introduced them to a lot of people who may not have heard them otherwise, who may not have known about Little Richard or about Ivory Joe Hunter or Fats Domino or any of the other folks that Pat Boone covered. And yeah, it doesn't make sense. Should Pat Boone have had the bigger selling or the bigger hit record of those songs? Probably not. But the fact that he was able to get people to hear them.
Oh, sure.
And
but even like with Elvis, he covered Carl Perkins' Blue Suede Shoes,
sure,
and correct me if I'm wrong, Elvis wound up with the bigger hit for a couple of reasons. One, because he was Elvis, even though I think Carl's is equally as good, if not better.
Oh, sure.
B, there's a story that Carl was on his way to a gig with some band members, and it was an accident. It happened at a critical time in the promotion of the record. So he was laid up with a broken leg or broken bone somewhere in his leg and took him off the road. So he wasn't doing any TV, any radio, any concerts. And, of course, that just, you know, propelled Elvis's song even that much farther. So, you know, and they were both good. But once again, I still give kudos to the writer and the performer. I thought Carl's was the better version.
And that was still in an era, and I mentioned this in the class that I teach, when a song was still, it was starting to fade, but and rock and roll pretty much killed it. The song was more important than the artist, which dates back to the early days of the Victrola. Because in those days, you had the song plugger, the guys who would go from record company to record company selling the song or the rights to it, mm-hmm. and then each company would have their, they would choose an artist to go and record it. So at any time, especially during the 20s and 30s and 40s and a good part of the 50s, you could buy that song by one of a handful of artists. So for example, when Banana Boat came out, Deo, this goes back. That was one of the last songs where that happened. And everybody knows Harry Belafonte's version. But at the time, a group called the Tarriers had the bigger hit version, and the Fontaine sisters had a version. And there was at least two or three other. Sarah Vaughan had one. And they were all pretty big chart
but
hits.
Some of that, in the case of the first two acts you mentioned, some of that also was not just companies trying to capitalize or beat them to the punch. It was also somewhat related to race, bias, whatever. Whereas Belafonte, who I believe is Jamaican or Bahamian by birth, all of a sudden, we're going to play the more saccharine version.
That is true. That's certainly.
So that's
been,
where when you start mentioning the Fontaine sisters noted. And the people that were certainly talented, but still, right away you're thinking, wait a minute, why are they doing that song? And of course, what's the one that comes through now loud and clear? All you got to do is go to a Yankee game and you hear Harry Belafonte whenever they get men on base.
Exactly. And the other part about that, and I know we're kind of going off on a tangent,
but that's good.
And another thing that I mention and teach is about the show Your Hit Parade. Now, I don't remember the program.
No, I was
too young. Went off the air in the late 50s.
57, I believe.
But the whole part, that show was all about a group of very white bread singers adapting pop songs that were the top songs of the week in different settings and motifs. So when they had to do Heartbreak Hotel or Tutti Frutti or any of these very big R&B records, they would just be an abomination.
The only thing I can equate it to would be like a non-competitive American Idol. Only the thing was these people like Giselle McKenzie and Snooki Lanson, whatever. Mm-hmm. Don't ask me how I know that because I wasn't even born when the show was originally on. But again, these were people that every week they had to come up, kind of like a more hip wouldn't be the word, upbeat version of what became like a Lawrence Welk show, where people that did not have the hits were performing those songs and then, entertaining people, and people liked it. It was a form of hearing a different version. And as you said, that's where it's an interesting point about that the song really was the focal point, the artist. Okay, we know who did it, but look, what a rendition this person does.
Yes.
And sometimes they were better, sometimes they were worse. Before we get off of that, remember Ted Mack's original Amateur Hour?
Oh, of course.
Yeah. Now, that was really a very simplistic version of what later became American Idol. There were some great people, I think Patsy Cline, Brenda Lee, I believe. Gladys Knight, that actually competed and or might have even won on that program.
I don't remember if she won. But
no,
I
know Patsy Cline did, yeah.
Patsy Cline and, of course, Robert Klein.
Yeah, oh, yeah, he was
and
on there.
He was doo-wop. He had his group, the Teen Tones. One of his funniest routines was about the appearance of Robert Klein's doo-wop group on the Ted Mack Amateur Hour.
Nice.
Irene Cara, one of the last ones before that show left, when she was like maybe 8 or 9. Great clip if you can see it on YouTube.
Yeah, because the NFL football kind of forced that out because the game started getting longer. It used to be on Sundays at like 5:30.
With College Bowl.
Yeah, exactly. College Bowl on NBC. Yeah, so it got to be a little tough. But Ted Mack, that's a... you know, something to investigate for sure. ThatThingShow.com, our guest Rich Appel, That Thing with Rich Appel, airing in so many stations. Again, for more information, ThatThingShow.com. We started talking a little bit about your, we'll call it your day job, teaching as an educator. Share a little bit about that. I assume that's, you've been doing that for longer than you have
actually,
this show.
Actually, not that much longer. No. Actually, I've been doing radio longer. That only came to be about maybe 4 years ago. I had worked most of my life. I worked in the research, market research, consumer audience research area for the media. 7 years of that, I did that for television. And for 20 years, I did it for the music business at Sony Music, at Columbia Records.
Didn't Epic. You work at, when was it WCBS in New York at one
yes.
point?
Yes.
Was it radio or TV?
Channel 2.
Channel
I did
2,
that, yeah,
okay.
I haven't, yeah. Radio I was away from for a long time. I started doing radio when I left, when I finished with school. And it was very frustrating. I'm sure a lot of people have the same story. It was hard to get a foothold, even though those were quote-unquote better days for radio. This is in the 1980s.
Yeah.
I couldn't get a break. I had little things here and there and always loved them, but they never lasted. And when I got a call, when somebody got my resume somewhere in New York, I packed up and left. And radio and me didn't intersect again till about 25 years after the last show I did in the 80s. It's just a strange circumstance, and I got pulled back into it. But during that time, I got to, when I was doing work in the music business, one of the guys who used to be at Sony, in fact, the guy who was chiefly responsible for the compact disc, was teaching a class at, I think it was Fordham University, and asked if I would come in and talk about the research part of it, and that became a regular thing.
Nice.
And I realized I liked the interaction with students, and I liked teaching. I couldn't imagine doing that any more than that one time. And then a few years ago, a friend of mine who had been asked about teaching a class basically declined for lack of time, but recommended me. And there I was. So I've been, for the last four years or so, I've now taught at 3 different universities, and really everything you can imagine on the spectrum of radio, broadcasting, media, speech, public speaking, ethics. It's amazing what they've thrown at me. And somehow I've managed to teach all of it. I've taught journalism and writing for media. I created a class in the history of broadcasting, which I've just begun to teach. And the big, as you can imagine, the big challenge with these is that you hear that, and maybe you're thinking, and whenever I mention this to people, they'll go, wow, I'd like to be in that class. And I say, well, if only my students felt the same way. It's a different perspective.
Sometimes the ones that want to be in there aren't the ones in there, vice versa. Yeah.
Well, there have been isolated situations. Certainly there are. I've got some great students. I've got some students that actually have gone on to do radio or work in broadcasting or video and follow through on their interest. So I can't say that's anything I did. I think they had that in them before me.
But it's still a great compliment because I'm sure they remember the time they spent, in your class. I threw this in. This must be the dungeon at the Appel Mansion. This is where he goes. He and Beyonce there, if you can get see that. And I don't know. I think it's Scooby Doo there, and I'm not sure what those other two. But that's your
archive.
Frosty
and Little Frosty.
Frosty and Little Frosty.
That's the part of the the Chestnut Cabaret.
Right. It blew out of my mind there. What is a Chestnut Cabaret? Those who have listened to that thing with Rich Appel, the Chestnut Cabaret. I keep thinking of some place in Pennsylvania.
Because that's where it was. Did you know that?
No.
Philadelphia, and I didn't realize. The very first show that I did, I just came up with the name Chestnut Cabaret. It sounded like
something from a Glenn Miller song. That's when I first heard it on your show. And I'm like, what the hell is a Chestnut Cabaret? So, okay.
Well, I went to school. I did undergraduate at the University of Pennsylvania. And I had totally forgotten about the fact that during that time, this would have been the mid-70s, there was a club on Chestnut Street, because in Philly, all the streets going one way are trees, so there's Chestnut, Walnut, Spruce, and there was a Chestnut Cabaret. And it was in the back of my mind, and the first program, I mentioned it throughout, and somebody goes on my Facebook page and goes, you know this, there was a Chestnut Cabaret in Philly. And it's like, dong, you know, it hit in my head. It was like one of those George Harrison, My Sweet Lord, He's So Fine moments.
He claims he didn't know he did it.
Yeah. And I didn't know that I'd stolen it from the club.
Since you brought that up, to me, a total travesty. Love both songs, but to me, one is like an anthem, you know, and the other one is a nice song, you know, by a girl group written probably by Carole King. I forget who wrote He's So Fine.
I don't think it was Carole King. I'm not sure if it was anybody we know.
To compare that with My Sweet Lord, I mean, I don't hear it. I've never heard it. I think it's just a bias on my part that, to me, when Harrison had to pay damages and then he lambasted back with a song called This Song.
Sure.
Yeah, which was kind of a shot back at that whole travesty in the mid-70s. I think that even drove him even further from the record business, but that's just a personal opinion. ThatThingShow.com for more information on our guest to my left, the lovely Rich Appel, That Thing with Rich Appel, airing worldwide. Too many stations to even run down.
We're on in Slovakia.
Oh, Slovakia.
We're on in Slovakia, like, the Netherlands.
So that Putin joke must have gone over real well, right?
I wonder.
You have to translate I'm your puppet into Slovakia.
I do get tweets, and I get mail of one sort or another from, I know we have listeners in Australia and the Netherlands and Belgium, certainly, of the nine, I think we're in nine countries.
Wow.
So we got a work to do still.
There you go. Let's go. Who has influenced you outside of your field? You have many fields, but I'm saying, in other words, we'll stick
so
with...
So not
like,
Ingram, so not the real
no,
John
yeah,
Steele.
Somebody that, in other words, that maybe you look to in what you do, how you present yourself, how you conduct yourself, what you've achieved in life, but yet you say, geez, you know, how did I... Oh, you know what, I owe that. Some people say their parents, their an uncle, you know, some, you know, Einstein. I mean, you know, anyone that comes to mind.
Well, that's a good question. No one's ever asked that question before, and I'm not sure... I have a good answer to it.
No, that's okay. No, just kind of a throwaway question. You know, I just thought it was
you're a
multifaceted guy, so I just thought, you know, there was some driving force. Besides, obviously, like you said, you know, radio, the love of radio. In my case, when I was a kid, I wanted to be a cameraman, I wound up getting into radio, but then look where I am now. You know, now it's like, you know, move that camera. Oh, let me take the lens off. Oh, let me take the lens off my camera, for that matter, you know, so.
I've never thought really beyond those people on the air that I was going to say stole, but I want to say borrowed from, or whatever you want to. I really didn't steal, but every now and then I'll say something and I'll realize, oh, you know, that's the way that J.J. Jeffrey would have said it. Mm-hmm. Or that's something that Dale Dorman would have done, or that's what the real Don Steele would have done.
Well, look in television, and you never hear that someone appropriated or stole, and it's a compliment, but also the person doesn't always get the proper due. Letterman, Jay Leno, and there's a few others, but those guys, especially Letterman, again, a lot of this stuff all came from Steve Allen.
Yes.
Okay. And
absolutely.
Steve Allen is another guy that, again, who, you know, was an early host of The Tonight Show, pre-Johnny Carson, pre-Jack Parr, did many things for, you know, several decades afterwards. A funny man, what they call a raconteur. You know, he was a songwriter, book author. He just, you know, did had like 50 projects going on at once. But this guy was a genius, and not to take anything away from those other guys, but they took it in another direction, and I think that's how you have to look at it, you know, is that you're, but in your case, you're almost, it's like a pilgrimage to, you know, bring folks back to a genre, an entertainment facet that isn't prevalent now.
There's that, and also, and I don't want to sound like, you know, I know what I'm really doing, or that I'm, that I have all of this figured out, but I feel like a lot of it is trying to bring people back to radio, radio itself. Because one thing I've noticed is that a lot of people, people that we, in our generation, who did what we did and always had their transistor or always had the radio on in the car, or had it on at the beach and lived with their favorite disc jockeys, and it was not just about the music, it was a soundtrack.
Oh, sure.
And I feel like most of those people now have, because of the way radio has evolved or devolved, depending on how you look at it, are content to just get the music and play it and go to Pandora or get a Spotify playlist together or use their iPod or whatever they're using to play music. And that suffices.
But some of that, too, is also for two reasons. I agree the personalities aren't there like they used to be. Also, there's this barrage of commercials where, look at a ball game. I mean, you know, strike two. Oh, and by the way, that's brought to you by blah, 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 blah. It's this constant onslaught, and then places are still saying, well, we're not making enough money. And I can barely watch a game. Or in this case, it's on the radio. But to go back to, you know, the jock genre, you know, probably in a you know 58 minute segment accounting for news, they might have 6 minutes of commercials. Now it's like, you know, like television. Now it's 42 minutes of music or whatever, and then 18 minutes of commercials. The same thing on television. I mean, you count commercials, we sit there, my wife and I, and sometimes there are 10 minutes of commercials, and we're like, when does this movie end? Well, it should have ended at 9:30, but it's ending at 11 because we are just pumping the viewer full of products, and that's great. But it makes people in radio then tune away and go to where they sacrifice content and actual good humor, good writing, so that they can just hear the songs because they're being bombarded with too much other stuff.
I think maybe people have been doing that anyway, regardless of any of the other content. I feel like radio may be starting with stations and programmers, even as far back as the 60s and 70s, which were telling disc jockeys to not talk so much and just play the music, and we're just going to have these jingles and you're going to only say this or that. And it got to a point where I think with many people I grew up with, they never really cared about disc jockeys. It's about the music more so. So when I try to pull people back in and say, well, here's a show where we're trying to entertain, we're trying to use personality and give something more, we want to add value to the program, and I'm not sure a lot of people understand that. And I know that, I think about this, I'm very grateful to you for having me on this program and using an hour to promote this show. But I'm thinking to myself, chances are pretty good that out of all the people watching this, maybe, who knows how many, but probably some maybe single-digit percentage of them will actually make the effort to listen to it, will go to the website and click on a station and hear the stream or turn the radio on
once they know which station carries it. Yeah.
And if they do it once, they may never come to it again. I've seen people who are listeners via Facebook, people who I've known, people whose names I've seen who have praised the program, and then suddenly they're gone.
Yeah.
And like a lot of that is that people just move on, or they find that, well, I like the music and I just want to hear the music when I want to hear it, as opposed to interact with a personality.
I mean, the last one that I would say I listened to who kept my attention because of what he did as a jock of sorts, even though now I don't think most people would call him that, was back in the NBC days, later on in FM radio, Howard Stern.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, that kind of thing. I mean, there were guys where I'd be driving and I'd be stuck on the Merritt Parkway here in Connecticut, and you'd look over and it's like that commercial where the guy's singing Sweet Caroline.
Yes. I had that happen to me, by the way.
The only thing is, in our case, the windows were up, and I'd look over, and I'd see people rolling in laughter, and then I'd go to them, like, you know, give the letters for the, you know, 102 or whatever, and they're all, it was like kismet. We all knew why we were laughing, and that was when he was still on FM
radio.
Well,
it's not unlike, I was explaining this to students the other day, the beach phenomenon in the summertime, back when you had transistor radios and people didn't really use those crappy earphones where you plugged it in the transistor radio and put it in one ear.
I never liked things in my ear.
Yeah, oh God, and the wax would build up on it, the early, before the earbuds, and you could still have a conversation with somebody, but most people just had the radios playing. So when you walked, when you were like there at one point in the beach and you had to go to the snack bar and you were walking across, you would know what everybody's listening to. You would say, okay, here, this is RKO, this is BZ, this is, or whatever you happen to be. Because the music, the stations were the soundtrack of people's lives, and between the beach and the cars and everything else. And that experience, I've had that experience too, where I'm in the car, I see everybody else laughing to Howard at the same time.
It was uncanny. I mean, it was like you were stuck in this like traffic that was moving 5 miles an hour, and you didn't care. And then when you got to your destination, like at this particular point in my life where I was working with other people coming from other parts of the tri-state area, and it would be like, okay, before we even sat down to do what we were going to do, it was right away, well, did you hear what Howard did, or did you hear what that? Mm-hmm. That's the kind of thing I think that in your own way that you do. And again, maybe it's because I'm more old school, where you take the whole package because you're entertaining, plus featuring the music, the jingles, the commercials. The folks today, again, you know, like I said, I think they just want to drown themselves out with just music. I can't really think there's a couple, but I don't even know if they're nationally that, you know. I mean, we're living in a society now where even on some of the stations that you're on, we have people, and we talked about this off air, I would bet you money that they think Wolfman Jack and Casey Kasem are still alive.
And that's the other interesting part, that when I go to stations trying to get my program on and they're playing this music, primarily the same music I'm playing, my competitors are all up there, between Casey Kasem and Wolfman Jack and the Real Don Steele and Charlie Tuna, and
Cousin Bruce, he's still around, but he's more of the
alive.
He's
That's
on
difference.
Sirius,
right.
Limiting.
But the syndicated shows, most of them are hosted by folks, and they're being repackaged.
Imagine if whoever owns the NBC archives when he was on WNBC, when it was 660 before it became a sports talk, someone must have, if they don't, then they're crazy. But it wouldn't be the first time NBC erased, shows. They erased television tapes of Steve Allen, some were lost in fires. But from a radio standpoint, can you imagine the worth of early 80s, mid 80s, late 80s Howard Stern radio programs?
I've got a lot of those.
Some of the bits
I was
that
one
he
of those
do.
Chronic recorders. I used to keep a cassette in the machine every day, and when I went to work, I would when I knew I was leaving my apartment, I just hit record because I didn't want to miss anything Howard said.
Oh, absolutely.
And so I know that feeling, and look, I should be so lucky to be that kind of personality. How great would it be if someone said, and every now and then someone does, someone might send me a note and say, what you said today was, it was really funny. So
oh, sure.
I should only have that.
You mentioned as we wrap up the hour, is it That Thing on Facebook? How to?
I think if you just type the two words, That Thing on Facebook, poof, you're there.
Yeah,
we have a page there, and also, it's just one more thing we've got between that and the website, thatthingshow.com.
And for more information on the great Rich Appel and the marvelous show, thatthingshow.com for more information. And when you listen to it, you'll think of that sign or you'll think of that clock that was just on. The only difference is that clock is telling me that it's time to go. Rich, there it is right there. The only thing is the time is wrong, but I'll fix that. Don't you worry. My thanks so much for you making the trek up. We got to do it again.
I'd love to.
Definitely going to get a bunch of you guys, past and current jocks, and I'll just sit back and let everybody swap stories. Let me tell you, it'd be a great time. And there he is. He's even an artist. Look at that. Look at that.
That's my daughter who drew that.
That's your daughter. Very good. Very good.
Very talented. Way more talented than than her dad.
No.
Trust me.
I'm sure equally so. Equally so. Thatthingshow.com for more information with our guest, Rich Appel. And we are at the end of another great episode of Studio 411. Larry Dasilva, your host, we thank you so much for joining us. Before we head out, we are going to hear another snippet of the great Rich Appel, how he closes his show. So why don't we give that a listen?
As opposed to the mediocre Rich Appel.
Yes, well, him too,
him
too. But we will see you again next time. Take care.
To your senior year.
I don't believe this one needs any explanation, class of 1971 seniors. Take yourselves back to spring of 71 when I imagine you said or sang this quite a bit as the days to graduation counted down.
I just want-